Thank you.
Okay, I have my talk now. A question is, what if? It's got a mix of some keratoconus stuff and also more of a general talk, not just directly linked to this presentation. So these are my research grants from companies and some national grants. So when you look at this picture, we all know about this because this is Charles Darwin and his discovery at Galapagos Islands. We all know about it, what he did, and we all know that don't know about him is he was actually an accidental tourist. He was not supposed to be in here. He did not plan to go in here. He was not selected to go in here. He went in here because the captain of the ship, HMS Beagle, which we all know, was suffering from depression, and his family wanted a very happy-go-lucky guy who could keep his moods high. And at that point of time, the only person who was free and who was happy-go-lucky was Charles Darwin. And he was picked up into that ship. And he did not do all this like the mythology behind him is. He just randomly picked something, and that's why he was called an accidental tourist. But the question which is important here is, later in his life, when he became older, he started looking at, little older, maybe he started looking at what he actually found and how this could change how the evolution processes. The second thing is, he was not the only one at that point of time talking about evolution. His grandfather also had written a book. He had it in his family. But only thing which differed from him from being an accidental tourist to an accidental scientist was he started asking, what if the things he picked up from that region were completely different from what is seen? So then he started writing, then he started drawing his picture, everything. And then the mythology made him to look like this, that he was running behind all these animals out there. So remember one thing, he just went there to give a captain a company. So that's my story also of so far about trying to be an accidental scientist. We never started the journey being this. A lot of people may not know Hindi here. I am also not good. Log kya kahenge has killed more dreams than anything in this world. We are worried about what people say. We are worried about if I do this or discuss this in this session or anywhere, what am I, how are people going to look at me and how am I going to be looked at it differently? So this is what we had to come out of it, whether in practice or anywhere in your life. Sometimes you have to go into a different level because the tuning you talk, because many times when we started looking at this conference, we had only the group of people like you all who are interested in this kind of music. The people who are not interested in this kind of music will not come. There's no point trying to force people because you'll not be interested. So instead of changing the music to the people, you probably start mixing with the people who like the same music as you are. And that's what life is all about. So what is the secret ingredients of asking what if? How do you have to connect to your clinic? So always our philosophy, this is a very old slide, many of you might have seen it. It always starts with the curiosity, and curiosity need not always start, always does not start the day you start doing something. It's just like, remember what I said, the story of Charles Darwin. He came back and then he started thinking. And the question leads to answers, sometimes good answers, sometimes bad answers. Then you call it as a translation research. That's the beauty of all these things, what we do. The biggest what if has been asked to me many times and to a lot of my clinicians out here is, can good researchers operate? I think Dr. Farad and a lot of people, they've asked the same question. The question here is, it's not in India, anywhere in the world. A good researchers, or if you publish or you present, that means you are bad in surgery. So we had to change that mindset. You can still be good in everything. Like yesterday, I never seen a music played better than what Dr. Kamal did in my entire life. And he's a brilliant surgeon, everybody knows. And in the evening, he takes a different avatar. That does not mean that he's a good DJ because he's a bad surgeon. A good surgeon can also have good different things. That is what the big challenge is all about. The second thing is, we have dissociated our body into mathematics, cells, molecular, metabolics, because that's how it makes us easy to understand. But God, or whoever has created us, there's no differentiation. Everything is same. So, one of the what ifs is, what if we start mingling with people who are not the same type as we are? And what happens with you mingle the people is, they will tell you something different. You do not draw anything out of it. So what if we protect every single thing we collect? If you are into my OT, or retina OT, or glaucoma OT, at the end of the day, there's a bunch of these things lying down in different samples. And each one of them was sitting here. The job is to, after they finish the surgery, and they also do the surgery, to take it back to the labs. That's what happens. And some of them actually go back to the labs and preserve it. So what I learned from a Nobel laureate once is, when somebody says as smooth as butter, your what if in you, the genes in you should kick off and say, at what temperature? Because if you don't know what temperature, a smooth of butter is a useless idiom. So for example, there was a day when we were removing epithelium, and we randomly remove epithelium, we never care about, because for us it's junk, it just goes off. So one day when we are removing the epithelium, there was epithelium which would come off so easily when you're doing cross-linking, there was epithelium which would come off very tightly. And that day we asked the question, what if they have a different signature, and what if epithelium which comes off loosely has a different signature than epithelium which comes off tightly? Then we took all this epithelium off. In the interest of time, I'm not telling you about how what we did, but believe me, a lot of experiments were done. The epithelium which comes off loosely in your cross-linking are the ones who have more inflammation, are the ones who have more scarring, the ones who have more pain post-operatively, ones where the epithelium is holy. And we graded the epithelium. There's no grading of how you remove epithelium, but we graded it ourselves, like smooth, easy, and tough, or something like that. Compared to the other eye, where the epithelium was much stronger, the process was different. The pathway of healing was different. The healing was different because your cornea has more inflamed, so it heals differently. When you have inflammation, it will heal differently and you'll have scar. And so we started changing. So what if we start changing? If the epithelium comes off loosely, then we have to be very careful about how the healing, the sterile infiltrates. We used to start using doxycycline on them, more steroids on them, because we know that they would end up in scarring. A small what if of how you remove the epithelium can be a huge implication on how and what you're going to give the patient as a final outcome. Sometimes the mind does not always see what the eyes, mind does not know what the eye sees. It's a classical thing. One is the tear film. I think we have shown enough of this, because we always pick up one aspect of a tear film, that is what you can do with the outpatient. But there are a lot of stuff out there, including how the optics can play a role. This has always been asked to me by people, that when you say something, there is no literature evidence on this. Literature is created by you and me. If it's not there, it does not mean it's not existing. It's just waiting for it to be published. So each one of you here are much, much accomplished surgeons and researchers than me, but we have to publish. Because if you don't publish, the world will always say that there's no literature. The world does not have literature because you are not writing it up. This is one classic example of what I said, the log kya kahenge. We were ridiculed many years back about this, because everybody in India has vitamin D deficiency, yes, but that means that everybody should get vitamin D eye disease, was the pathologic. As a scientist, I said, that is like saying, as smooth as a butter, but you'll have to ask at what temperature. Yes, that is true, but if you don't get it, it does not mean that there's something wrong in the logic. Just means that you are genetically or environmentally or epigenetically predisposed to having that deficit. Like each one of you, all of us smoke in this room, imagine. My hypothesis, all of us will not get lung cancer. If you need to have a gene, you need to have an environment to cause a lung cancer. That's exactly what happened. But it took time for people to believe. So what we did, we kept publishing. Every year, every quarter, publishing on the same subject to build the literature. And if you look at NIH grants today, the NIH and US and RO are more excited than India about vitamin D. There are rows of papers on vitamin D and how it can change the haze by RO, big institutes, bigger than us, the researchers which are bigger than us. This is exactly what I said. If you have all the three components and if you put a Venn diagram there and the center, if your patient proband is here, only then you get the disease. That's how the beauty of this whole thing is. Then we started about this question, is it inflammatory? Again, when we said it was classically called a non-inflammatory disease, I got a PhD working on this, and out of 170 odd publication, at least 70% of it was not on keratoconus, but proving what if it's completely different. It took a lot of time, many times, many rejections, sometimes very bad rejection, but still it works. And we can probably look at how to build a customized procedure. One day when we are removing the epithelium, I'll just skip this slide, I thought, if keratoconus can, what if the keratoconus is not uniform all over? If keratoconus may be different. So what we started doing is, I took the epithelium only on the cone, and I took the epithelium around the cone. And I started sending it to the lab, and they found that the cornea had two signatures. The cone was not the same as the periphery in every different patient. That's why you ask the question about haze is because the healing pattern in the cone and the periphery is not the same. So that is what was very interesting about this. And yesterday we spoke about lysyl oxidase. We found that if you have a good amount of lysyl oxidase, your cross-linking works better. That means many, many things in your body itself. It's not your machine. Somebody asked the machine, Anant asked about is my machine causing most haze? Don't blame you and the machine, because there are different things out there which may be the factor. We can, if you read this paper. We have a new Corvus today, because this is a prototype which we told the Corvus company. The Corvus measures the center of, the Corvus measures the biomechanics, which is the center, which causes the biomechanical change. But if your cone is in the periphery out here, what happens here is it is not measuring that. So your biomechanics is always going to be false. So we help to design this Corvus which measures different parts of the cornea and works on it. And there are a lot of mathematical algorithms which we don't like, but we have to work because that's what's going to be the future of it. So what we see everything differently. Last few slides. A tears can check whether your myopia is progressing because dopamine is there in the tears and dopamine is important for your elongation of your eyeball. Anand, my colleague, won this Rangachari this year about how an ROP children, you can screen them by your tears and the VEGF is actually picked up in the tears and you can tell you the state of the retinal proliferation. It's a very important paper because it becomes a point of care for places where you cannot keep sending the children all the time. It's a big find. And this is what our dream is. We are working on for point of care for everything, like a glucometer, all which we discussed today. I still ask a very random question. It may, at this point of time, you may laugh at me. The question is, can keratoconus be driven by a bacteria? This is a question, and somebody laughed. They said, everything is driven by a bacteria. But trust me, we are very close. We it looks funny now because we don't, first of all, it's very difficult to accept that it's an it's a non-inflammatory process. Very difficult to accept that it could be a bacterial driven one. I may be wrong, but we took the swab. We had not we did not do the culture. We cannot do anything about it. We had to do a genetic analysis of each bacteria, which costs a lot. So Arka could do a few of them. We have some lead there. Hopefully, God willing, we find a reason. And that's probably one of the reasons somebody said that, you know, doxycycline kind of drugs works in these cases. Thank you.